To our next lecture in our Year of Peru series. My name is Dan Paraca. I'm Director of Education Abroad and co-coordinator for the Year of Peru. So I'm happy to answer any questions you might have after the lecture about study abroad or the Year of Peru in general. We're doing evaluations of the different programs, so if you didn't get an evaluation, you can get them from, it's Scott, is that right?
Sam.
Sam, fine. From Sam, and turn them in there at the end of the event. I want to highlight one of the upcoming events on September 22nd. At 8 p.m., we will be hosting a dance and musical performance by a group called Inca Sun. And that's going to be a great event, a great show, performance. And it'll be at the Bailey Performance Hall. And the tickets for that are $10 a piece. So you need to go online to the box office, to the College of the Arts box office website, and you can purchase your ticket. I think we'll probably have a sellout show, and so you may want to get your tickets soon before they're all gone. And that is an event not to be missed. Today's topic and speaker are one that couldn't be left out of the Year of Peru, neither the topic nor our guest lecturer. The topic, the encounter between Atahualpa and Pizarro, and our speaker, Professor Julio Ortega from Brown University, is really one of, if not the most foremost expert on Peru in the United States, and in the world, for that matter. Professor Ortega is originally from Peru, and he's a scholar, he's a poet, a playwright, a novelist. He has written over 15 books, and was teaching recently at the University of Texas at Austin and then at Brandeis University before going to Brown University to head Hispanic Studies program there. He's been a visiting professor at quite a number of universities, including the Simon Bolivar Professor of Latin American Studies at the University of Cambridge, and the my Spanish is not so good. The Catedra de Estudios Avanzados at the University of Venezuela, the Central University of Venezuela. He's an editor and publisher of other scholars' works, with again, maybe I'll try to translate this. I'll probably get it wrong. The library series of Ayacucho, and the coordinator and editorial counsel for the archives collection in Paris. So several, and then one at the University of Pittsburgh. So several journals that are publishing continuously on Latin American studies, where he is serving as the editor. Now I think I'll stop there. I'll let you talk, because I don't want to take any more of your time. But we are really, really honored and pleased to have you with us on our campus.
Well, thank you for coming to talk about Peru and the beginning of everything. Pleased to be here in this week dedicated, or months, or year, dedicated to Peruvian topics. November 16 and 152, Pizarro and Atahualpa met in Cajamarca for the first time. And this encounter, which is intriguing, almost a novel, has many accounts, documents, stories, even films, and still is going on. And it's being represented as the first encounter of Europe and Latin America, or Peru at least, and in a play, a series of plays, in the countryside in Peru, which is very intriguing. Why the Peruvian people, peasants, still reenact the beginning of the conquest, which is the defeat and the domination of the power of this old culture, and probably because they are still trying to understand what happened and why they met in Cajamarca this famous day of November. There was something in common about these two guys, Atahualpa and Pizarro, which is that neither knew how to read or write. Because Atahualpa obviously was from an oral culture. The Inca culture never knew the alphabet. They don't have a writing sign system. And they had a recording sort of technique, which is called quipus, but probably it's more mathematics and accounting of a decimal system, but not a real language. And Pizarro was the illegitimate natural born child from a rich family in Trujillo, Extremadura in Spain, and apparently as a child, very poor family, not recognized by his father, work in charge of some pigs, etc., because the pigs are the richest product stock in this area of Extremadura. And the story says that when Atahualpa was in jail, he was very curious about the writing system, the Spanish, and he wanted to be the first student of Spanish in jail, and he got some words, and the first word that he learned was Dios, God. And he wrote in his fingernail, Dios, and showed it to Pizarro, and was very surprised that Pizarro couldn't recognize the name of his own God, because he was full of irony. Apparently Pizarro, Atahualpa, was kind of an ironic person, trying to understand this conqueror. Atahualpa, of course, was a very small guy. Pizarro was also small, short, but stocky. A very famous soldier, very brave soldier. Obviously, Atahualpa was the most powerful person in the all over around. No? But this is not only the meeting of two people representing two different empires, but also the meeting of two different languages. The Spanish language, which is an analytical modern language, made of sections, particles, propositions, prepositions, declinations, and the Quechua language, which is an agglutinatory language, you know, like the Greek, that you can form a long sentence in one word, made of different parts of the language, no? Like Latin or Greek. And all traditional ancient languages in America are like that, you know? based on the principle of agglutination, which is very different conception of the word, because the first difference that matters now is the syntactic nature of the language. Because if you have a Spanish or any modern language, you have a range of syntactic construction. No? Syntax is very important because it's the order of the words in the phrase, which means the order of things in language. The order of the word on language. No? Syntactic is how we order, organize the universe in language. And the way that Spanish work, especially at the beginning, is like a conqueror language, which means that things are two kinds, those similar to us, that we can name, and or those different to ours that we don't know about. Which is very, very natural reaction of a conqueror in front of a new culture. But the system, the cultural system, is so powerful that it immediately tries to incorporate the other culture into its own terms. And to do that, the culture through language tries to reappropriate otherness in order to transform this strange thing into familiar things that you can control, and also to convert into your own system, which is against your system. In that sense, it's a language of discrimination. In the sense that reorders reality to separate things. By nature, modern languages work like that, separating things. If you are in the ideology of a religion, of a dominant empire, like the Catholic religion, you're always doing that naming, you already pass judgment. It's inevitable. It's part of the culture of the power, or the power of culture, which is that in naming, there is a process of reordering the world, the new world, in order to control it. Quechua is totally different. In Quechua, you don't have new things. Obviously, there are many new things, but every new thing is not part of a system value, good or bad, is part of the language. Because in the syntax of the Quechua, you can incorporate new things. So there is a new god, his name is Jesus. All right, very good. He has a place in the syntax, immediately. Together with the native god. There's no conflict. The native god, Pachacutec, for instance, one of the gods in Quechua, is a cousin of Jesus. Because it's together, both together, in the same phrase. Let's say that the bull shows up suddenly in Peru from Spain, a huge importation product. And they say, who is this guy? We never see something like this. It's totally new. But there is an explanation. If there is a new thing so powerful like a bull, has to be a word from the god. The god lives inside the mountain, the Quechua god, and it's called Huamani. And the Huamani has a peculiar way of talking. Yeah? He sometimes talks loudly, and he produces a word which is a bull. So the bull is coming, and say, okay, the god is probably in bad humor, and he is speaking with this product. So he has a place in the syntax immediately. He is not an enemy, let's say. He is not probably a friend either, but he belongs to reality, and he belongs to the cultural syntax of Quechua. That's the first major difference between these two emblematic figures, Atahualpa and Pizarro, in the encounter. Two different systems of naming, which means two different systems of evaluation and incorporation, which means at the end the place of the other in language. It's curious because we know now that ethics is not the good opinion we have of our own conduct, but ethics today is the place of the other in the I, the place of the other person in my notion of myself, which means that our morals are not a product from ourself, right? From the place we allow to the other to have in myself. It's very interesting. That's how the Quechua works sometime before this idea. The place of the other is part of myself. The other, this is too long, but I'm going to be kind of synthetic on this. The other big difference is the conception of time. The conception of time is totally different. For the Incas, time is kind of a spiral, moves like this. It doesn't move in the same place. Move like coming and going, but moving ahead, but returning. No? Circular time is called, or mythical time. For the Spanish, a modern culture, obviously, time is lineal. Come from the past, cross to the present, goes to the future. That's the conception that we all have. Conception of history, chronology, chronos means the measure of time, the notion that something began, develops, die, or flourish before, and the notion that in modern times, the notion that the past is there, the present is here, but the important thing is future. We are the only culture that values more the future than the present or the past, no? Which is characteristic of modernity. Everything has to be better in the future. That's the modern quality of our notion of time. Time, as we live it, comes from the Judeo-Christian tradition, when the first couple is expelled from paradise, they start walking into time. Okay? That's the myth of origin of our notion of time. That's why it's so important to be rich now for the Spanish, no? And the obsession with gold. Gold, which is very interesting how they see gold, the Spaniards. Kind of a medieval notion of gold. They thought that inside the air, all the metals are sort of alive and moving and trying to interchange and mix between them, because all the metals want to be gold. That's the idea. Very optimistic idea. And that's why it's so difficult to find the gold, because you see a bright light in a mountain, you dig there, and there is no gold. Already move ahead. Away. Also, as you know better, gold was the basis of the modern civilization. But in Peru was so much gold. Hundreds of blocks of gold were transported to Europe. And the fifth part of that gold was called the Quinto Real, the fifth part for the king. That was the tax from the emperor from Spain that he kept from every gold that was available in Peru. No? Of course, Drake was around waiting for the float. Twice he caught the whole gold. No? But when the gold arrived in Spain, it was so much gold that the economy collapsed. There was a big, huge inflation in Spain, and they were very poor, and after the Peruvian gold, they were still more poor. No? Because the king was so in debt, and he has to pay so much debts and bills around Europe, that he used the Peruvian gold to pay this, and in the process the gold created the notion of the bank, no? The credit, letters of credit, savings, interest, an institution in charge of your money that was created in Italy first and in Flanders, and a huge bourgeoisie, a new class of rich people emerged, no? And so was it, and that was the final destination of the Peruvian richness. But this circular notion of time that the Incas had means that something starts, go on, and end, and start again, and end again, and start again. It's called, these are called ages, like in the classic world. So the first age is called the right age, or the right age, and the other is not the wrong age, but the war upside down, topsy turvy. In the right age, you have everything is green, there is no hunger, there are no plagues, there's no. The air is very. The products are there. There is justice. There is good government. Something happened. They call it a Pachacuti. Pachacuti means the end of the world, catastrophe. The catastrophe could be an earthquake, a hurricane. Well, hurricanes are not in Peru, but or the coming of the Spaniard. Coming of the Spaniard was technically, or mythically, end of the world, like a catastrophe. So a new age comes. So we live in a world which is, and the time, which is the right world to be, and suddenly we are in the other side, in the upside down world. What can we do? Well, we have to work to accelerate this process in order to be again in a new positive world. So life is not so fatalistic that we agree that cosmic history change, but everybody has a mission to try to make up to terms and be again in the right world. In the meantime, this is a very difficult time, of course, the Incas has to negotiate. There is no explanation that we have still Indians alive. There's no explanation. They probably died 10, 20 million, we don't know. Just by first contact from the flu, they died like 100, 1,000, no? Just for the flu. Also for labor, etc., for violence. But why they are still alive is amazing. Because they were, from the beginning, extraordinary negotiators. They never rebel. They try to negotiate with the Spaniards. They have this language that allows them to incorporate. And they even humanized language. Like the Mexicans, they record it and they eat it. And the idea is to be to transform into a human terms even the violent process of the conflict. And every law that came from Spain, they took it literally, and they demand the laws to be put in effect. That's why they say that in Peruvian Indian communities, native communities, there are more documents of their own legality and rights. They say also there are a lot of dissertation, PhD dissertation by the anthropologists than Indians alive. But that's part of the, it's part of the negotiation to document your capacity to negotiate. But there was also a different conception of space between Europe and the Americas, the native, the Indies, so-called. The space for the Spaniards that came was a structure of power. No? The city was built as a map of power. You see a map of the city and you see the organization of power. And they built the cities and gave away the houses or the right to build houses to the conqueror. The conqueror were the first owners and the first expression of power in the city. And they kept the Indians as separated, as protected, let's say. The space in the Indian War is very strange. It's based in the notion of a rectangular space, like a soccer field, and in Quechua it's called cancha. That space. It's curious because that word went into the Spanish also. And the soccer fields in Spanish are called now cancha. Cancha. But this space, I say that everything has a place in that space for the Quechua world. Everything has a place there, even this encounter. You have this figure, rectangular figure, called cancha, but inside there is another rectangular figure, a smaller one. It's called cancha cancha, which means that the second space is a conceptualization of the other space. And this principle of organization, which is in all spaces, is always another space, explains many things in the Quechua world. Explains the construction of the temples, the notion of the empire. They have four places, four areas, and the division of the world in up, high up and lower. Two binarian system of the organizing the space, and each part is also divided in two. So everything is divided in four parts. Cusco, for instance, the whole city is a temple. And it's organized in squares, inside the squares, like a temple. No? The word Cusco means, what's the name, neighbor, ombligo?
Navel.
Yeah? Like Delphos, the center of the world. So this notion of space explains also the extraordinary ecological control of the land. As you know, in the Anden, the Tahuantinsuyo empire called Tahuantinsuyo, which starts in Colombia, goes to Ecuador, Peru, Bolivia, North Argentina, Chile, a huge empire, they developed an agricultural system which is called verticality. Because of the highlands, you are in Lima, zero level, and you go in an hour, you are already climbing, no? Up to 6,000 meters. And in between the sea level and the top level, you have 6 different climates. In one is summer, and in the other is winter. In Lima, now is winter, and in Cusco is summer, no? Because of the high lands. So you have 7 climates, means that you have different temperatures. And you have an area, which is at the middle, which is the best land, which is called Yunga. And the anthropologists discovered this system of farming in 7 floors, ecological floors. When they discovered in the book, in the colonial books, they discovered that a guy has 3 houses. And they say, how a guy could have 3 houses? Well, because he was living in one part of the year in one ecological floor, the other in the second, and the third, close to the sea. And that's why at the same time they were cultivating potatoes in different climates. And there were more than 2,000 species of potatoes. Now we have, I think, 1,000, more or less. That is the explanation for the absence, total absence of hunger in Peru, no? In the Indies, in all the Andean area, they never knew hunger because there was plenty of food. When somebody was born, immediately he has a piece of land. That was his right, a piece of land in the community. And this means also a huge system of irrigation. No? There's a map of irrigation organized by the Incas. So a total control of space, which means that the geography was a human geography. Yeah? But of course, in order to do this, you have to have a powerful state and organize the people, distributing labors, etc., production and preservation and distribution. And this means that it was a powerful bureaucratic state, probably organized by regions, not by one huge state, but by regions, separated regions. When the Spaniards discovered this system, they kept it, because it was so productive that they didn't want to destroy it, obviously. But when the Republic started, they start the Hacienda system, which is huge land property, private property. And the Hacienda system cut the ecological divisions by the middle. So hunger started again. It was a very primitive way of production, the Hacienda, because it's medieval, or even pre-medieval times, no? Feudal, a system of accumulation of land without enough production. So also this difference of space between Pizarro and Atahualpa, which is fascinating also. I'm already talking 1 hour. my sense of time is. But this encounter also has a story which goes beyond the cultural context, let's say, that I try to synthesize for you now. And has to be with the recording of the encounter. It's interesting because we don't know anything about the details. But that happens all the time. A leader is killed, no? Moctezuma, according to the official history, was stoned by the Indians, no? When Pizarro took Moctezuma in front of the Indians throw stones to him and kill him. The Indian version of the killing of Moctezuma is different. They say that when Cortes took Moctezuma to show him to the population, he was already dead. And he was sitting, still in his chair, and they throw stones to the use of his body by political reasons, which was very Machiavellian, no? To do politics through a spectacle. No? So the curious, the explanation from the Indians is that he was stoned not because of him, but because of his manipulation. We don't know too much about Atahualpa, but that he was judged, condemned to death, and they told him, do you want to die on the stake or strangulate? And he said, what's the difference? He said, well, the difference that is that you accept to be baptized, you can die in the garrote, no? It's called in Spanish garrote vil, which is a tonic, no, that goes through your and destroys your UI immediately. And obviously he chooses that because his body has to be preserved. An emperor can be just burned in the stake. But after that, he died quickly, but we don't know too much. But there are two kinds of records. The record from the Spaniards, which said that there was a strategy from Pizarro. 60 guys with very primitive arms, but very surprising for the Indians, never saw power, no? In such a way. Probably 20,000 Indians. Atahualpa went to say hello to them, welcome. But Atahualpa demanded explanations why they were stealing goods in his way to Cajamarca, the north of Peru. And the priest, Valverde, showed him a book. Atahualpa. Book. Yeah, and Prince Valverde says, you should talk to Pizarro, he loves you. He has been sent here by the king. And this is the book of our religion, and you should listen the word from God. And there was a translator, his name was Filipillo. Filipillo probably was an Indian from Nicaragua. In the islands of Nicaragua, they were trilingual because of the different tribes there, groups. And they were very young boys, who bright, that learned many languages at the same time, and they caught the Spanish quickly, but half of it, no? So Filipillo translate for the Inca into Quechua what Valverde said, and the Inca took the book and put it inside, here, to hear the voice of God. No word. He threw the book. Yeah? And that was the signal to charge. The priest said, Spaniards, we have been insulted. Our God has been desecrated by this heretical guy. And they charged and they picked him up, and it was a killing. That was the beginning. There are many versions on that encounter. In one of the versions, it says that the book was a Bible, which is strange. By the way, Pizarro also can read the book. The Bible in a small book probably is not the case. Probably was a priest manual or something. Maybe it was in Latin. None of the Spaniards will be able to read it either. And another account, it says that it has some claps, the book. And the Valverde, the priest, was trying to open the club. And he was taking a long time. The Inca took the book and he opened the club. Try to hear, throw it again. He always throw the book in all the versions. That's the only recurrent topic. The discussion is, because Hispanics were very good on legal discussions, yeah? They were very slow. They took a long time because, you know, from Spanish culture, the difference of, there is no punctuality. You know? Punctuality was invented by the Swiss in Switzerland. But that's why, what's the name of this English general said that we hope death come to us from Spain, it will be late. Wellington, I think. They took a lot of time discussing what to do with Atahualpa. Atahualpa said, I know you want to kill me because of the gold, but I have a lot of gold. Why to kill me for that? I can fill this room, he was in his jail, up to here, gold, one room, and two rooms also up to here, silver. He was short, and no one thought too much, but nevertheless a lot. And he ordered every of his generals to bring on gold, and the gold came, but too late. They were going to kill him anyhow. It's curious, we don't know anything about him after that, but on the other way, we don't know how big people die. No? For instance, if we think in Kennedy, we know a lot of little, almost trivial things. We know how much it weighed the piece of brain that she, Jacqueline, got in his hand, her hand. No? She walked with the piece of brain from Kennedy. It was measured and recorded. We know that she claimed what's the name of the arrow?
Ring.
The ring. But the body was all swollen. No? They couldn't take the ring. So she ordered to cut his finger to take the ring. We know these things, but we don't know who killed him. Or we maybe believe, we prefer to believe that somebody killed him, but it's amazing, huh? So if we don't know now, much less then, but. So we don't know a lot of things about his death. We don't know if he really converted into Christianism. Maybe he didn't have time to understand. There's a parallel history of a cacique in the Antilles that he was going to be killed, and they told him, if you baptize, you can go to the skies, to heaven, but if you don't baptize, you will go to hell. And he asked, where are more Spaniards? In hell or in heaven? And they say, heaven, of course. I don't want to go to heaven. Anyhow, the interpretations of the Spaniards differ in accounts, but basically all are in agreement that he had to die, had to be killed. Nevertheless, this is typically Spanish, of course. No, it's impossible that everybody could be in agreement. Cieza, who was a humanist, writes in his chronicle, this is not good because the Inca totally ignored what the book is or was. So there is no offense if he throw the book. He didn't know that it was the sacred book for us, written by God. Supposedly, the Bible was written by God. And that's why Fray Luis de León, when he suggests that could be a good, better translation, he went to jail 3 years in Spain. That's his point. This is not cause enough to condemn him to death. And there are other discussions like this, legalistic sort of discussions, but very interesting because obviously to kill an emperor is a major sin. Eh? The Indians, on the other hand, produce immediately after his death a poem that present another interpretation. In this anonymous poem in Quechua, translated now, it says, the soul, the sun, has lost, let's see, the sun is like a head without a body, and everything is dark. In this image of the soul, the sun, without the body, we see a metaphor of the lost of the emperor, whose body is the emblem of the nation. No? So the notion that he was decapitated went into the popular lore, and the Indians all ended up believing that Atahualpa was decapitated. It's very interesting. One of the Indian intellectuals, Guamán Poma de Ayala, draw those two pages that I pass you here. No? How we look for these other images? So here we see the Spaniard, two Spaniards, cutting his head, and this is a drawing by Guamán Poma de Ayala, one of the first Indian intellectuals who wrote a letter to the king. He was very naive, Guamán. The conquest started when he was 13 years old, and he was very bright. Immediately he learned Spanish and started to write, and he started a letter to the king. The letter ended up taking him probably 13 or 14 years to write, and instead of a letter was a manuscript of 300 pages, a very long letter. Because he thought that the king in Spain didn't knew anything about what's going on in India. And the Spaniards, because of the hunger of the gold, looking for immediate richness, were lying to him. And he decided to write a letter saying, "Your Majesty, your conquest is not going good. Too many violence, too many injustice, etc., etc." It's a long description of what's going on. And he started by drawing the Atahualpa's healing. He knew, because he was an intellectual, and he read all the historians, that Atahualpa didn't die that way. He knew Atahualpa died in the garrote. But nevertheless, he represented this because it was the symbolic death, let's say, the mythical death, the loss of the head of the emperor, meaning the loss of the empire. Atahualpa is holding the cross, as you see, and he looks very young, almost as a child. And50 years after this history, a young prince in Cusco who was supposed to be the new Inca, rebel. He was caught and he was killed also. And Huamán Poma also drew his death exactly like Atahualpa's, like a cutting of his head. This time we see the crying people here. He's the less younger, but it's kind of a theatrical representation already, because of the repetition. So we see that the history is read through myth, through mythical consequences, our interpretation. No? Inca Garcilaso de la Vega, another Peruvian intellectual from 17th century, he was the son of a very famous capitan, Spanish aristocrat, conqueror in Cusco, his only son, and very bright guy. He was in the school of the time, learned Latin, Spanish of course, Italian, and he went to Spain when his father died. The father left for him silver, a lot of blocks of silver. His mother was a descendant from the Incas, a princess. But a law came from Spain saying that a Spanish gentleman can't marry an Indian native. So he had to left the wife with Garcilaso, probably 14 years old, his son, and he married a Spanish woman. So the boy grew up seeing this political separation of her parents. That's very interesting. But he was a real intellectual. He didn't believe that Atahualpa was killed by violence or by imposition of power. He wanted to believe that Atahualpa was killed because of a mistake. That's very interesting. Because if he accepts that the Spaniards were unjust, brutal, and violent and irrational in killing the emperor, the meaning of the conquest, which is the coming from Europe to America, doesn't have any sense. Because it's a new encounter, a new war, starting in violence. And he can't tolerate that. He has to have an explanation in which God, which in his plans decide that the Spaniards conquer Indies, has to have a better plan. So in his account of the encounter of Atahualpa Pizarro, he says that the problem is translation. He was a humanist, of course, and he thought that everything is a problem of communication and language. No? And he thought that Filipillo was a very bad translator. He didn't know properly Quechua, and he didn't know how to translate to the Inca the good intentions of Valverde, the priest. That's one thing. The other thing is, Valverde was a very bad priest. He was a commoner. He didn't have any education. He was a true believer. And he just was reciting without knowing the religious fundamentals of the Catholic faith, and he was unable to persuade the Inca. Why? Garcilaso says this, because according to the theology of the time, the Incas, obviously the Indians, they decide have a soul. No? That's what the first discussion. Yeah? These guys are like us. Do they have a soul? Conclusion, they have a soul. Okay, so they are like us. Second, they can be slaves. They cannot be slaves. If they have a soul and are like us, they can't be slaves. So they are not the natural man, from Aristoteles. The natural man, the man close to nature that is not fully human yet because doesn't have a moral experience. So this theological discussion means at the end that for Garcilaso, that in his plans, God, who wants to evangelize the Indians, knows that in order to receive truth, you have to be ready. You can't have truth from a revelation. Truth has to be taught. You have to learn the process of religious truth, which is an old philosophy of teaching and training someone in the moral responsibilities of truth. No? So, if a better priest and a better translator were present and have been present in Cajamarca, violence probably was avoid. The only explanation of violence is a mistake, it's a wrongdoing because of bad translation and a bad priest. That's his explanation. It's an amazing explanation, it's a philosophical explanation. But one explanation that also proves the capacity of the Indian culture to appropriate the instrument, the highest instrument of thinking, moral thinking, in order to give a place to his own defeated side in the general project of God and empire. No? So we see here a cultural strategy of Garcilaso de la Vega, the historian, trying to have a better situation for his defeated people. Not as defeated, but as bad trained people. That's a typical humanist. So we have these two big intellectuals, Huamán Poma and Garcilaso, trying at the end to explain in philosophical and political terms the encounter. To finish our talk, I will tell you now about the popular interpretation of the encounter of Pizarro and Atahualpa. It's very curious where, how, and we don't know when, the people, the peasants, start to reenact the encounter. In different towns, during different festivities, suddenly somebody appears in the guise of Pizarro. With a false beard, and somebody appears dressed as Atahualpa, like in a theater, in the plaza. No? And all the characters from the encounter are also dressed like that. Spaniards are dressed as policemen, regular policemen. And so they act. Exactly what happened according to history. You have to become a Christian if you don't want to die on the stake. What means to be Christian? Etc. There's a kind of reenactment. Not historical, of course, but popular interpretation of what happened. In some places, more not small towns, but middle-sized towns where there is a radio in the town, the radio is transmitting. The guy who talks instead of transmitting a soccer game, he goes there and says, Atahualpa is going to be caught. Now Pizarro has Atahualpa. What's going to happen? Like it was a sporty event. And there are many different versions of this. Some versions are as old as the 18th century, and some versions are from last year. The 18th century versions are very strange. Atahualpa says, they sent me this letter, but what is this paper? What is this? This looks like a vegetable leaf or something, sort of leaf. What are these signs? They look like ants or the steps of a bird. Let's ask the chairman, our chairman, to read and interpret this. So the Inca says to the priest, go to sleep and let us know later what do you learn when while dreaming. Nice. So in order to know the truth, the priest, the Inca priest, has to go to sleep. And he comes, I just wake up, I have good news. It's incredible. It's totally popular, mythical folklore, no? The interpretation of the encounter. The new ones, they are teachers, students from the town, the guys as Atahualpa, Pizarro, the priest, the soldiers, set all the characters, no? Doing it. So the question is, why town or people has to reenact their own origin in this way? It's like we reenacted yearly September 11 or the killing of Kennedy. Doesn't make any sense, or the Lincoln. Strange, no? So we don't have explanation for this. Why they reenact this encounter? The only thing I can say probably is that it's still intriguing, the encounter of Europe and the native world. It's still without a plain explanation or resolution. It's still part of the construction of the national identity. And it's one story of origins that start as tragedy, you know? And perhaps in mythical sense, what starts as tragedy should be preserved as a lesson to follow up with different and new solutions. Thank you.